Hi, I'm Diana Montford, the world's first transgender television journalist. Look it up on YouTube. I've been doing this show since 1990. Anyway, my guest is, oh, by the way, I transitioned from male to female. People say, what direction are you going in? They do, because of the hair, you know. So many people say, oh, so when are you going to have, like, top surgery? No. I mean, I born male, became female. I think I'll let my hair grow a little, you know. Anyway, my guest is someone you've seen before and love, Miss Brooke Cerda, who is a transgender activist. Yes, she's a woman of transgender experience, like someone else, you know. So anyway, here we are with Ms. Brooke Cerda.
Thank you, Diana. Such a beautiful introduction. Yes, I'm a proud transsexual woman. And I'm also, like I say, an activist. I probably just celebrated 5 years of my career here in New York City, specifically working for my girls. My priority is trans women of color because, statistically speaking, are the population most vulnerable.
Absolutely.
And so I try to, you know, amplify their voices as much as I can, because it's not about me. I feel like I'm not looking for a career. I'm not looking for anything. I'm just looking for my community to have, you know, a better place, you know, in life, in society, you know, because it is just plain horrible.
I know. Now you're of Mexican descent, aren't you?
I was born and raised in Mexico in April 6, 1965. So now I just turned 51 years old.
Oh, I wish I could say that. I just turned 60.
Oh my, really? Mm. Wow. And it would say that you're younger than me.
No. That's why we invite her back.
No, it is
politician
true.
Girl,
it is
yes.
True. I feel like I'm not sure exactly where to look at this time. This is a new studio.
Neither am I, because I'm looking here, there, everywhere.
For me.
Hello, camera.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's your camera over there.
Okay.
Yes. No, okay, where's she looking? Where's she supposed to look? Where am I supposed to look?
This is a new studio. I mean, the other studio was like, okay.
Yeah, but this is a better studio.
I got
We've
it.
We've come up in the world.
No, it's...
Comparatively it's speaking.
Okay, so I'm just going to look at this camera. Thank
yes,
you.
Yes, you're welcome. And give me close-ups too, okay, Molly? Look, you come on me, you're way back there. I want my close-ups too. Just a couple of crazy trans gals talking to the director. Our wonderful director, Malik Parker, who's only yes. wonderful if he gives me close-ups.
No, yes. I think...
I want close-ups like hers.
This is the best camera I've ever gotten. I'm like, I'm looking at my camera because... And the other videos that I did, I don't look as good as this one. I don't know if this is a new studio for me. Maybe also that's why. But anyway, let's stay in topic.
Yes.
So... It's June. The whole June is Pride Month. I recently went to a public hearing for the Stonewall National Park.
Right.
You heard about it?
No.
Yeah, they came from Washington just to hear.
Well, what are they? Are they going to make Sheridan Square right across from the Stonewall?
Oh no!
Stonewall. Good. I
no,
like my close-up. Thank you. I'm ready for my close-up.
This is a national park.
Yes.
This is a.
Where is it? Like
park.
In Alaska?
In New York.
Oh,
no,
okay.
It's going to be in New York. So, ka-ching, ka-ching.
Ah, yes. Dinero.
So everybody, they moved in, and it seems like it's going to go.
It's
up to Obama to approve it.
He will. And, he's cool.
Yeah, I'm sure, yeah. So that's going
to
be...
And look, they used to arrest us, and now they have parks named after us. That's good.
I know. Didn't you tell me that you used to go to school?
I went to this school called St. Joseph's School, half a block away from the Stonewall. Hi, everyone who went there with me. My name used to be Vernon Campbell. Now it's Diana Montford. You may remember me. The nuns hated me. They used to smack me around. That's why I became a dominatrix later. I wanted to join the winning team. But anyway... yes, I went to school half a block away from the Stonewall just when the Stonewall thing was happening, but it was summer vacation and it was like 1 a.m. and I was 13, so I wasn't there. But I remember the Stonewall. I remember the wonderful Sylvia Rivera. and other, Marsha P. Johnson, all the great activists who are no longer with us, sadly. I used to see them in Sheridan Square Park in the morning when I would go to school. They'd still be up and cavorting and enjoying life.
So, yeah, you also told me you got to see a lot of arrests, a lot of, you know...
Well, no, I never saw arrests of trans people at that time. I did see...
No, queer people. You told me, I think,
LGBT. No, I never saw arrests.
You didn't tell me that?
No.
That people used to get arrested for no reason?
Yes, but I never saw it. But it was common knowledge that people got arrested.
Oh, it was common knowledge. Okay, so that is a minor. This is how... This is stories that need to be told several times. So this is how the rumors get started.
Yes. No, I never saw anyone get arrested for being LGBT, but it was common knowledge that certainly trans people could be arrested. In those days, if a trans woman, and the interpretation was quite broad then and now, didn't wear three pieces of male clothing, or if a trans man didn't wear three pieces of female clothing, that person could be arrested. And it was basically up to the discretion of the police officers. They got around that, for example, by trans women wearing, say, turtleneck sweaters from men's shops that were in the color pink or something, and trans women would wear, you know, t-shirts from women's shops that looked just like men's t-shirts. And throughout Greenwich Village in the 1960s, there were shops like Uptight Village was one, where they sold men's clothes that looked very much like women's clothes, you know, like peach palazzo pants, but with a label in back that says testosterone man. Yeah, you know. So I mean, you know, whatever. People, they figured it out, you know.
So you have seen a lot.
I have seen it all. As Marie Antoinette said just before they executed her, not just, like a few days before, I have seen everything, I have known everything, and I have forgotten everything. Then they cut her head off, you know? Yeah. Hey, don't get smart ass with us, Marie, you know? We're the ones with the guillotine, you know, bitch? Yo. Revolution.
Damn.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it is pretty surreal because...
Well, we're pretty surreal.
As I understand, it's only been... It's going to be about 15 years...
Since what?
Since trans women can go out during the daytime.
Oh, no, because, look, when I first transitioned, I was so awful at it. I mean, I'm... Like, oh, that's a guy, right?
But
so, I mean, nobody arrested anybody.
No, not the arrest. You know, basic. I mean, it was like, I mean, I don't know if you're aware of that, you know, but I heard so many accounts that.
Of what?
That it was considered like a suicide to go out in the daytime.
No.
I heard from a lot of trans
women.
Listen,
I had jobs, like in the real world, selling cosmetics and everything. We had to go out in the daytime.
I mean, because you were stealth. But if you were not able to go stealth...
I didn't wear a t-shirt that said nobody knows I'm transsexual.
If you were not able to go stealth, if anybody will find out, something like that, then...
I
heard about public lynchings. They were like...
Get out of here, not in New York.
Especially in the Bronx, yeah. In
the
Bronx and in Harlem, in certain neighborhoods, yes.
Harlem's always been very trans-friendly.
Yes, this is a lot of the older transsexual women I talk to, they say, because, you know, last year we lost... 23 women in the United States.
Yes, only one of whom was white, and she was killed by her father.
When he
was like this crazy born-again white guy Christian, and he found out she was transitioning, and he stabbed her. He'd rather have her dead than be a woman.
Well, that's what the Republicans are preaching. Are preaching hate, are preaching intolerance, are preaching that, you know...
Being a Mexican woman, you must be very... uncomfortable with Donald Trump and his, like, we'll build a wall, yeah!
Well, I think that's a great idea. I feel like I've seen
my
country...
Yeah, but put him on the other side of the wall.
Yeah. No, but I've seen my country go down the hill, you know, especially after, you know, Operation Fast and Furious. I don't know if you... WikiLeaks. Remember WikiLeaks?
Yes.
When WikiLeaks came out, there were, like, tons of information.
Uh-huh.
So Operation Fast and Furious revealed it was an operation that injected lots of... tons of high-tech weapons,
uh-huh,
and lots of millions of dollars to the cartels in my country.
So, your country of origin, Mexico.
Mexico. So since then, I don't know if you watch the news. You know, my country, they have actually, what's it called, taken over. They elect themselves into, you know, like, small municipalities.
Careful, and they might come get you.
And from there,
or your family.
It is very dangerous. It is very dangerous, yes. Mm-hmm. It's nothing that to kid about. And I feel like, you know, it is really sad. This is why, you know, I'm voting for Bernie, because I feel like, you know, it is so crazy, you know,
I admire what Bernie has to say, but I don't think he's electable. I'm voting for Hillary because I think she really will get the job done. That's a democracy. We're allowed to disagree.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. No, but I mean, as a Mexican, I feel like, you know, we cannot afford more imperialism
that's true. I have to admit, siendo española, my family's from Spain, my mother's family, it was we, the Spaniards, who took over Mexico, you know?
That's a nice way to put it.
Yeah, we were the first imperialists, yes.
Let's move on. So, no, but I mean, especially NAFTA has been so devastating for our original communities. You know, they're like,
you mean indigenous communities?
Indigenous, the indigenous is also known. So people now, they're claiming that NAFTA has shortchanged the United States when, you know, we did not write NAFTA. NAFTA is a treaty like this big. It's like a phone book, and it has so many things. But at the end of the day, you know, I mean, you go, if I was to go back home, which I can't because I'm undocumented, you know, it looks like another United States. They have every franchise. They have everything there because of NAFTA.
Excuse me.
It's another United States.
Did you just say you're undocumented?
Yeah.
Aquí en este país?
Yeah.
Porque lo dices en la televisión.
Because I am out. I mean, it's like I try not to unpack so much. The first time that I come to your show, I'm supposed to vomit everything. Like.
Yeah, but aren't you afraid they'll get you and take you back to Mexico by force?
No longer afraid. I mean, it's enough. 25 years is enough.
They and should give you citizenship
whatever happens
after 25 years.
It's the United States. They'll do whatever they want. They taken mothers out of their little babies. Vice versa.
Well, don't you think they might
throw
you out?
You think they're going to care about me? Well, if they throw me out, they throw me out. It was a good run. Don't you think 25 years?
Yeah.
And if the universe wants me here, the universe is going to keep me here somehow. And it's not because I...
Cut. We can't show this.
No,
No, they'll...
It's on my Twitter. It's on my Facebook.
Okay, don't cut.
I have done civil disobedience about it in front of the White House.
Don't cut.
I'm also... I'm sorry, I thought I told you.
No.
I'm an immigration activist.
There's something else I need to know. You mean you weren't born female? The wedding's off. I'm sorry. Well, how do y'all like that?
I'm sorry, Diana.
That's not like, a clit, is it? I damn.
It is like it's so much stuff that we have. I'm sure if I start talking to you, I'll find out a lot more things about you.
No, I'm stupid enough to tell everything right off the bat. The worst thing I ever did was be a dominatrix, and I keep talking about it so people will think, hey, isn't she sexy? I'm not. But, you know.
Well, who knows? Maybe after people watching this, they might say, hey, I want to come to her show as an undocumented person and tell them, you know, what I've been doing.
Yeah, so, and you don't mind talking about it on international television?
No.
We're seen everywhere.
No.
Yes, we're seen everywhere.
No,
thank you, God.
Of course not. You know, when I first came to the United States, it was 1989. It was unthinkable, unthought of. Nobody, you were like, no, you know, it was all about assimilation. This is why, you know, a lot of people, they love my English and stuff, because during many years I looked for assimilation, and it did get me a lot of privilege and stuff. But, you know, then, I mean, you know, it's like something that you sweep under the rug. Then start, you know, the panic attacks started and all this persecution and all this stuff. So
why
it's not worth it. When you're undocumented.
They come after you?
No, no, but if it's like in your head, it just all right, it's like yeah. in your like, you know, because it is everywhere.
Yeah.
I'm gonna be like, emotional. No, but I mean it is everywhere, especially we have raids. We started the year with raids in New York.
Really?
Yeah, you didn't know that? Yes, and it was really horrible, and all we can, you know, I was looking everywhere because I'm always on Twitter, and nothing. There's about 100 organizations were for immigrants, but nobody in those organizations are immigrants or undocumented, so nobody really cared. There was no information, and everybody was saying, oh, don't worry, everything is fine, but I know in Long Island, they were waiting for people outside Walmart. They were waiting for people everywhere in Long Island. I mean, I'm glad that I live in a sanctuary city like New York City. So I mean, it's like, you know, and I don't even have a jaywalking ticket. So
yeah.
whatever they, I know the moment I, yeah, if I get in this little much of trouble, I know.
But and you do a lot of good for the transgender community. So, I mean, if you, you know, contribute to society, and do your best to make it better. It seems to me that why should you leave when someone who was born here but does nothing for the world gets to stay, you know?
That's the United States. I don't know what to say. I mean, there's people there. Everybody contributes so much.
Is life better here than it is in Mexico?
I mean, especially now after Toya, after Operation Fast and Furious, after NAFTA, yes. Yes, I mean, right now, my country has become very unsafe. It has become it's really horrible. It's really horrible that so much poverty. I mean, we used to have our people just to go in the mountains, and you can live eating cactus and snakes and stuff like that. But, you know, because there was a big boom with the tequila, so now they planted all tequila plants, the mezcal, and now there's not even that. So what people are gonna eat now?
Excuse me. So poverty is widespread in Mexico.
Oh yeah. I mean it
is. Is that why so many people turn to the drug trade as the only way to stay alive?
Perhaps I'm not sure because I left, like I said, 25 years ago. I cannot even venture. On that. I mean, I have friends now.
Actually, 27 years ago.
No, 1989?
Yeah. It's 2016.
Really? Well, I don't know math. I mean, well, that's what I used to. I figured out. I'm really, 27? Okay, 27. Okay. Oh. Well, because I'm not really good at math. So I figured out 2 years ago.
Okay.
Thank you for figuring out. So, yeah, it is much, much better here. I mean, over there, the average salary, I mean, if you work your ass off right now, I think it's probably $100 a week.
Oh, my God.
And it's like,
can people live on that?
Well, there's a bunch of people there. So always, they have families over there. That's the beauty. When you have, you live with your aunt, your grandma.
Sure, in Spain too.
Everybody,
yeah.
So it's like everybody helps each other. And everybody's much happier than here. That's the thing you always meet, every time I meet my people, and it's like, they are much happier and they have nothing. So how do you equate that? How do you explain yeah. that? You know, how much people...
Would you be happier living in Mexico than here?
I mean, I'm not sure about happier, but safe, I don't know.
Would it be unsafe for a trans woman to live in Mexico?
No, it is very dangerous, especially in my hometown. A friend of mine actually went back. She lives here in the United States, in New York.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not gonna say where because you know somebody might figure out who it is. So she became really ill because she is a post-op transsexual woman.
Right.
And she had this complication and
a gynecological application complication due to her.
So she went to every hospital. Nobody wanted to touch her.
Oh my God.
Because she's like, oh, we don't know that. So she got so desperate because she was in so much pain and stuff was happening. She flew back to Guadalajara, and over there, it was like the same thing. Nobody wanted to treat her, and finally she went to this hospital and she found this lesbian woman. Uh-huh. And she told me, you better get out of here. They're going to kill you.
Oh, my God.
And she got really scared. Mm-hmm. Oh, and there was so she left a long time ago before she transitioned.
Right.
And somebody recognized her. So that was it. It was like wildfire. She got really scared. She got on the first plane back.
Right, right,
and it
right.
turned out that she had nothing. It was like some kind of like one of the dogs, something.
Some little infection.
But
yeah.
She totally freaked out because she has also right. mental issues, depression and anxiety.
Well, I wonder why. If she goes home and they want to kill her, that would lead to depression and anxiety, yeah.
Yeah. So she did not last, but she thanks this woman that she told her, oh no, don't stay here because yeah. they're going to. And sure enough, a year after she come back, one of her girlfriends, she was found in a black bag, garbage bag.
In Mexico.
In my hometown. In my hometown, she was found in the middle of the street in a black garbage bag, and she had her beauty salon. She had everything. She had everything set up. She had transitioned a long time ago and stuff, and just somebody didn't like you, and didn't even in the newspapers. I was the one who made a big scene. I was the one who tagged everybody I knew in Guadalajara. I tell them, you know, this woman got murdered. Like, how could you not gonna? Her name was Laisha. Laisha Sanchez, I think that was her name. And it was like, how can nobody? But it was terrified. In my home country, it's not like here that we talk about murders.
Right.
Oh no, people know. Because guess what? Cis women are getting murdered just as bad.
Oh my God.
It's just as bad. So it's like, in my country, we cannot even say about us because cis women is like feminicized. They call it feminicized and they call it gender violence. It's an epidemic in my country. I don't know in other countries. I think it's throughout the world. It's the war on women. There's a war on women. And we need to wake up and call it out. And we all need to unite because there's so much slaughter. Every time, you know, because I made a Twitter and Facebook in Spanish mm-hmm. only because I was fooling myself that I could do it one account. No, now that I'm on a Spanish thing, it's like every day, woman turns out in
a cisgender woman?
Cis woman.
Is this in Mexico or in the
in
US?
In Mexico.
Mexico.
Here in the U.S., I don't know, but I mean, I guess they hide things better here, perhaps. I don't know, but over there, it is like there was a big the only time that made big headlines. Remember they call it Las Muertas de Juárez.
Sí.
The dead women from
they would disappear, and
Juárez.
It was crazy. It was like.
The dead women. Like I think my lipstick is almost up. The dead women. Yeah, they would disappear. They was like we know there was no disappearance, and that happened for years, and nobody cared. No FBI, no nothing. And these women, they were just walking to the United States
right.
to go to work, to serve people and stuff. And on the way, they would be snatched.
Yeah.
They were into sex trafficking, into. I mean, horrific things, and nobody does nothing just because they're women.
Yeah. That's been going on a long time. In one of the caprichos, the artist Francisco Goya has a drawing, an etching, whatever, of a woman being kidnapped out of a stagecoach just because, and they're going to take her off and do God knows what with her, you know? Brigands along the road. So it's been, maybe it's part of Latin culture. Because there doesn't seem to be a lot of respect for women in Latin culture, I've noticed, you know?
I don't know where we got that from. I don't know.
La Virgen María, they should respect us, you know? But I mean...
You will think.
Yeah.
You will think, but it is just not the case. I mean, just listen to, even in this country, just listen to the songs. I think the songs
are
big.
Yeah, I'm gonna fuck you, bitch, gonna cut you bad, gonna fuck you purple.
I mean, even that, you know, like, okay, so at least, you know, it is that kind of things. But, you know, there's a song like, it's so innocent. I'm gonna marry you anyway. And that was a big
Whether
hit.
Whether you want to or not,
last summer is a big hit. I forgot who sings that. and I'm going to marry you anyway, and I'm going to, like, you know, oh, don't be so cruel, or don't be so, you know, and, you know, all this stuff. Always these women, or either demonize women, or...
Let me tell you something. I was in a pizza place called Luigi's on 86th Street 3 weeks ago. Unbelievably, and this is, and I'm not tooting my own horn, this 32-year-old guy tried to pick me up. It's a Saturday night. I'm getting two slices. I'm wearing big sunglasses, lipstick, no makeup. Yeah, I look, you know, yeah. Anyway, when I made it clear that I was not there to be picked up, that I was buying two slices of pizza, he was another customer. He said, oh, you got a real bad attitude. Oh, you know. Excuse me, I am not here to be picked up. I am not here to be molested. I am here to buy pizza and leave. Thank you. And I'm the one with a bad attitude. He's accosting me, and I'm the one with a bad attitude.
It's insane. It's because, you know, men are raised, and they're told, everything that's here, it's for you. Everything that...
Oh, we have 1 minute left.
Okay.
Okay. And everything that's here is for all women everywhere. Yes, power to... Sisterhood is powerful. Anyway, my guest has been Miss Brooke Cerda.
Till next time.
Till next time. I love you even if no one else loves you. I love you. I'll see you next time. Ooh, love you, love you, love you. Whether you're a man or a woman. Or something in between.
Yes.
Ooh. Where's that music? I don't hear the music. I need the music. Can't stop the music. Yes, the microphones are on. So careful what you say. Thank you.